So I think the hardest part every single day waking up is trying to decide, you know, which blue quarter zip I'm gonna wear today and which set of sweatpants. But we're getting there. I talked to some of my colleagues and, you know, they're scared as well.
It's biology.
But we're trying to make sense out of this remote learning as best we can. They look outside, you know, I see the parks are closed. Not a lot of people are out. It's a lot to take in. And I hope you guys are happy and healthy and doing some of your work at the very least. But I digress, and we must move on to remote learning.
So, what would you little maniacs like to do first?
One ear out the other, burning bright right till the end. Now you'll be missing from the photographs, missing from the photographs.
Okay, so now that e-learning is actually official, we have to actually go through and take a test on what we covered from beforehand. Now, what's different about this time around is that you guys get to use your notes for essentially everything on here because I really can't stop you. And so as we look at this, the unit we left off with, we covered solutions before we left. We vaguely covered equilibrium. And then those 2 weeks that we were kind of gone from one another, that's when cell transport was discussed. So I really quickly want to sort of reiterate some of those things we had talked about, kind of in order, so that as you go through this and you start prepping yourself for your exam, you at least have some sort of basis of like what we should know, what's nice to know, and what really is kind of irrelevant to this point.
What?
So let's start by looking at solutions. When we talk chemical solutions, we essentially look at the idea if we have some chemical solute that is thrown into a very similar polarity, think salt and water, and then we have an IMF interaction where the water can essentially dissociate the solute pieces. Now our focus this particular part of the unit was not so much on this idea of dissolving, but basically asking the question of if we have a given box or beaker of solution, you know, how much is in there? And our how much always focused on the idea of molarity, which was given by moles of solute per liters of solution. And so if we look at this particular situation, and we call this box 1 liter, and we call these dots each a mole of solute, well then we'd say the molarity of this particular box is, I don't know, 6 dots per 1 liter, or 6 big M. And that was essentially where we left off. Now where this got confusing is when we started having questions that weren't just dots. But we also asked questions, you know, how do we increase the molarity of a substance? And the obvious one was, well, we could add more solute pieces. But remember, we also could shrink down where the solute pieces are by essentially making less volume. That's all nice to know, but where we're at right now is, can we do the math for these problems? So if I were to give you some mass of some substance, your first goal would be convert that substance into moles, convert the volume of the solution into liters, and then really just divide the two. There's a ton of practice up on this stuff up on Classroom. You guys have seen this already, and I'm pretty confident that you can actually do this without me going through every single piece of this. If you have questions though, please, please, please email me, find a way to contact me as you're going through the actual summative. Regardless of what it may be, these reactants can collide with one another with the proper orientation and enough energy, break apart, and form brand new pieces. Now, what we end up lying to ourselves a lot is that this process only goes one direction. In equilibrium, we say that this process actually ends up going back and forth constantly, where the products themselves can bump into one another, react, and back form reactants. And so when we say something is in equilibrium, we talk about the rate of the forward reaction is equal to the backward, or what we'll refer to as the reverse reaction.
Oh, all right.
So as long as we have as many products being formed as reactants regenerating, we have reached what's known as equilibrium. Now, when we talk about this for a cell, this will be a bad thing, because when cells reach equilibrium, this is essentially going to be cell death. And so most of what we're going to look at is, how do we avoid this? How do we maintain the gradient inside of the cell? Things that you had to be aware of, or if we had a given chemical reaction in equilibrium, those are our little double arrows. And if that reaction ended up being exothermic, we could say energy is shown in the products. How can we shift the equilibrium around? In other words, how can we move the equilibrium toward the reactant side or toward the product side? So if I'm trying to shift toward the reactant side, I would need to increase my reverse reaction. And so you could think of this as basically saying, I could increase the concentration of C, I could increase the concentration of D, and what that would do is I would make my arrow to the left significantly bigger, favoring the reactants. I could also increase my temperature doing the same thing. In other words, we're finding ways to make the product side hit one another more so that we can increase the amount of reactants in this situation. But if we are trying to do essentially the opposite, you could imagine taking away from the product C and the product D, decreasing our temperature. All of these would create valleys in which we essentially get rid of our reverse reaction. And if you get rid of the reverse reaction, we're actually going to increase our products to try and reestablish equilibrium. This was all about this idea of shifting. And so the last thing that we actually brought up for the unit was entirely on your own, and that was cell transport. And there are a ton of details related to cell transport that are, you know, great to have if we were face to face, but really our basics is this idea of, can things flow with or against a gradient? And so for us to understand what a gradient is, we have to look at just the barrier of the cell. And the barrier of our cell that we're going to focus in on is just the membrane. Now, that's only going to apply to certain types of cells, but for us it's good enough because we just want to talk about what's outside the cell and what's inside the cell. Now, next year when you have Conboy in ICB2, he'll talk about, you know, how certain cells can have different structures that will allow other things to go from one side to the next. I'm going to focus just really on, what does the outside look like? What's the inside look like? What direction will things flow? Now, one of the most important things for you to understand is it's very difficult for molecules that are very large or very, very polar to transmit the cellular membrane, because the cellular membrane is made of phospholipids, as we've seen before back in our notes. So these large molecules kind of bounce into multiple phospholipids and sort of bounce back. These polar molecules sort of get entangled with the polar heads of the phospholipids and don't bother mitigating the cellular membrane, and sort of just remain on the surface level or the inner level, depending on where they are. Now, one of those really, really big examples of a case that can transmit the membrane relatively easily is H2O. Water has its own separate little channel called an aquaporin that allows it to essentially go straight through the membrane and sort of with its own gradient. Now, what we're going to focus in on is basically just this transmission of water going through the membrane, because every single cell has the ability to have water travel from one side to the next. Most solutes that exist inside of cell cannot move. And so if we have, for example, a situation like this, where we have multiple solute particles inside of a cell, we can imagine the cell, it also has a water environment both on the inside and outside. Now the cell is always trying to reach equilibrium. What that means is it would like to have concentration of the solutes on the inside equal to the concentrations of the solutes on the outside. And the way it can do that is by moving solutes, if it has the ability to, in other words, if it's extremely small or extremely nonpolar. But the other way it can do it is by diluting it and essentially allowing water to flow inward to the cell. This is the one that's a little bit more confusing. And so to illustrate this, especially on your summative assessment, what it will often refer to is that the cellular membrane is semi-permeable to water. And that is very, very common in introductory biology. So when we talk about this idea, if I have these solute particles stuck with inside the cell, what will happen is the excess water will rush into the cell in an attempt to dilute it. Now, if this is an animal cell with a non-rigid construct on the outside, this can be a problem because this is going to alter the shape and size of our cell. And now we have an issue where we have the cell that is no longer the exact same shape. If this were a red blood cell, this could become very problematic because maybe if molecular oxygen is no longer allowed to actually sort of sit on this red blood cell and transmit throughout the entirety of the body. The same can happen as if the solutes are on the outside of the cell. And in this case, solutes still can't transfer in and out of this cell right here, but water can move toward the outside and sort of almost like dehydrate this cell. And again, if this is an animal cell, we'll see this animal cell sort of shrink and crenate, we call it, into the point where maybe oxygen can no longer be carried along the cell if this were a red blood cell. Either way, what we're trying to focus in on is which way are things moving. Now these are all examples of passive transport. They're going with the gradients. So if we're going with water's gradient, we're trying to dilute things. If we're going with a solute's gradient, we're attempting to move these things away. So moving solute is diffusion. Moving water is called osmosis. And that's something that really gets deeper into context or details in your book. Your focus is that we're basically moving one way or the other. Now let's say, for example, you had a series of solute particles inside of your cell, and maybe only one on the outside, and you wanted to actually push this other one inward. Well, it wouldn't normally do that. Even if it had an opening to do that, it wouldn't go against the gradients. It wouldn't go against the separation. But if we added some energy, we could flick it into the cell. And that is the act of sort of avoiding equilibrium. Many parts along the outer membrane of the cell, we are constantly shoving various pieces out, or various molecules, only to have them flow back inward on another part of the cell further down the actual membrane. One of these particular examples we talked about where electrons actually land in photosynthesis, when we start talking about the generation of ATP. That's an ICB2 topic. Our focus right now is just realizing that most of the transport that we look at is passive, or in other words, goes with the gradient and does not require additional energy. If you want to go against the gradients, basically toward the side with more concentration, you're going to need additional energy. And that energy that we refer to is known as ATP. That is something Mr. Combo will go much more detail with you guys next year. Right now, we're just trying to see which way things would flow. So in this particular example right here, you would imagine these solute particles would flow out of the cell. If they're not able to, you could imagine that water, in this case, would attempt to flow into the cell in an attempt to dilute these various pieces. This would be considered what's known as a hypertonic cell in a hypotonic environment. So osmosis would be the flow of water into the cell from hypotonic to hypertonic. Diffusion would be the flow of the solute particles from hypertonic to hypotonic if they were able to actually cross the membrane. And in most situations, they're not. We could, of course, reverse this, and now we have a hypertonic environment and a hypotonic cell. So if the solute pieces can move, they'll flow into the cell in an attempt to reach equilibrium. In most cases, they can't, so water will flow out of the cell, decrease the mass of the cell, shrink the cell a little bit, and actually try to dilute the environment that it's sitting in. These are sort of our basics as we look at when we talk passive transport. If you ever want to go against your gradient or move a piece from inside to the outside, in this case, go from a hypotonic to hypertonic environment, you're going to need additional energy in the form of ATP.
Every minute and every hour, I miss you, I miss you, I miss you more. each misfire, I miss.